everybody. Thanks for tuning in today. We have the man, the myth, the legend, the number one pumpkin guy. You know, it's Ron Wallace. Ron, thanks so much for joining us today.
Thanks, Chad. Thanks for having me.
You're very welcome. I just want to get all the bookkeeping stuff out of the way. This is brought to you by the Rocky Mountain Giant Vegetable Growers. Oops, hold on. Error on my end. Rocky Mountain Giant Vegetable Growers, get out there, support your local club. Buy seeds from a pumpkin auction. Without the local clubs, everybody would be at a significant disadvantage. So go do that. Obviously, we got Ron Wallace with us today. I'm going to talk about him a little bit. Ron is generous enough. We are going to have seed giveaways and product giveaways from Ron's amazing product line. That'll be later. We've got Max here. Say hello, Max, everybody.
Hello.
Ask questions. Ron is always a wealth of information, so type questions, and Ron will get to them. So without further ado, let's just jump right into it. Ron Wallace is widely regarded as one of the pillars in the giant pumpkin community. However, before Ron was known for his role known as the Pumpkin King, Ron was setting out world-class food from the kitchen as an executive chef. Retiring from the food world, Ron started WallaceWow.com in 2015 with the goal of providing growers of any plant with world-class products and excellent customer service. It is common knowledge for some, but I will take this this opportunity to tell everybody about some of Ron's accomplishments when it comes to growing giants. Ron was the first grower in the world to grow a pumpkin over 2,000 pounds back in 2015. It was 2,009 pounds. And he's the two-time world record holder for giant pumpkins. Ron has been on all of the major TV networks talking about growing giants and rubbing elbows with some of those celebrities. Ron has been featured in the Wall Street Journal, Times Magazine, Boston Globe, Forbes Magazine, and many others. He's just too humble of a guy to list them all out on his website. Ron is the three-time GPC Grower of the Year, three-time world champion, winner of 25-plus playoffs, and was inducted into the GPC Hall of Fame in 2011. Needless to say, Ron is pumpkin royalty. So let's settle in during the next hour or so while we share, Ron shares his knowledge with us, and let's get to it. So again, everybody ask questions if you have them. Jason has compiled a list of questions. I have sprinkled in some of my own because I love asking Ron questions. Who doesn't? So the first one is, and it harkens back to your previous career, Ron, what is your favorite pumpkin dish?
Well, you know, pumpkin is great to cook with. It's a great thickener. It's a great, adds natural fructose and sweetness. I make a pumpkin paella with pumpkin and rice and shrimp and seafood and stuff that is pretty good. I kind of like that one. You know, you can use pumpkin for a lot more than a standard pumpkin pie and pumpkin soup and things like that. So people should, it's a great natural thickener for cream soups and other things like that. So people should really dive into it. Probably not the pumpkins that we grow, but the sugar pumpkin you can buy in the store at a farmer's market.
Just in general, Ron, like what? How long were you in the culinary industry? Like, where I believe you were at a country club, right?
Yeah. Well, I started cooking and was in my family when I was a young kid, and I went to vocational school in high school. Pretty much saved me from, I don't know how things would have turned out. So I really found a passion and a calling in high school with an instructor I had who took me under his wing and groomed me in how to be a professional chef. And I went to Johnson & Wales after that. And so I've been, was in food service my whole life up until 6 years ago when I retired and worked my way up. I worked through several restaurants, but I was at the country club for 33 years that I left. I was the executive chef. And then for the last 12 years, I was a general manager. And then I also helped with some of their other properties with, you know, running their golf courses and stuff.
Awesome. So the first question is, tell us about your growing area, Ron. Do you grow in a greenhouse? Are you wide open? Do you grow in the same spot every year, et cetera?
This year I'm going back in the same spot, so it'll be 2 years in a row. I do have the ability to grow in three different areas on my property. I do believe in rotating when necessary, but a lot of growers have been successful coming right back in the same gardens because they're paying really good attention to their soil and their biology. So I really didn't have time this past season to get another patch prepped, so I'm going back in the same spot. I start the season with a 20 by 40 polytunnel, and I put two plants in there. They're 5 foot apart, growing in opposite directions, and that'll go up in the first of April. The plants generally grow out the third week of April, and the greenhouse is down by June 5th or June 6th, and then they're on their own.
Gotcha. When it comes to like rotating your pumpkin patches, like me, for example, I'm in a greenhouse and I only have one spot. What do you think the main disadvantage is for people like myself or just anybody who doesn't have the ability to rotate their growing area?
You know, I've changed my stance on this. I really don't think it's a disadvantage anymore. As long as you've got, proper sunlight, there's so many products now that help with soil fumigation. You know, these products that have this periacetic acid in it and stuff, and, which is basically, hydrogen peroxide type products, but it's a periacetic acid in there, the percentage of that, which really does the fumigation to the soil. So it's a lot easier than using the old skull and crossbones things that were available up until a few years ago. And with, the industry has taken a big change towards adding biology, sustainable gardening. So with these products that are out there now and the ability to keep the soil clean, I think you can come right back year after year again if you treat your soils properly.
Interesting. That's a very good stance. I wrestle with that myself. I don't want to get into my thoughts too much, but there are so many good products, like products that you sell on your website that, we just jack our soil. We put so much good stuff in there and we try to mitigate the bad stuff. I do think that you're definitely onto something right there for sure. Other than growing giants, Rob, what do you do for fun in your downtime, the little downtime that you have?
Not a lot of downtime, but I have a nice, really nice vegetable garden. I have a classic 65 Pontiac GTO that I like to drive when I have. That's what I really do in my spare time in the summer. I like to take that out, spin the tires a little bit. It's a lot of fun to drive. Generally gardening and, stuff like that, driving a car. And, I like to go to a lot of outdoor concerts in the summer. That's, one of the things that'll occupy my time is going to shows, seeing live music.
Awesome. And two, I'm guilty of this. Your hospitality is exceptional. How many tours, how many people do you host, in growing season?
So many that we will lose count. we are a blessing and a curse that a lot of people come by all the time. And, and my close friends, Joe Jukers and Steve Sperry live right nearby. So we're always helping each other out. And that's the thing about Rhode Island. You can get from one end of the state to the other in 40 minutes. So everybody's within 20 minutes generally, unless you live down near the ocean. So we have a lot of fun. We get a lot of people to stop in, who grow pumpkins or people who are driving by and patch tours. And I always say some days it's tough to when people just stop in all the time, but someday I'll wish people came to see me, I guess. So.
Just come by.
We do enjoy the company and kind of leads to a couple of cold beverages and a good time.
Speaking of, so this has been one of the things that we've heard from several people. There's a lot of people that are going to say, watch this tomorrow-ish time zone. A lot of people heading their way to the GPC big show in Belgium this year. So hello to everybody abroad. Did you have any thoughts about going to that, Ron, or, small business, getting ready for springtime, just ain't got enough time?
No, this winter, I have a lot of responsibilities around the house here, some family stuff, and I just couldn't take the chance on leave even for a day or two to go anywhere. Because you get a day like today where you get over a foot of snow, that would be very challenging. So, and then we're really ramping up, you know, production and manufacturing. I know some people think I just buy products that are already in a bag and kind of put my face on it, but that's not how it goes. I'm involved with manufacturing. I'm involved, obviously, with marketing and website and Amazon and all that. So, and you know, we have a small staff, so we wear a lot of hats, and it's a lot of work. So, and this is a really busy time of the year. So I do love the GPC seminars, and under normal circumstances, I would have probably blasted out and had my assistant pull down the cloth for 5 days or so, but it just didn't work out this year, unfortunately.
Yeah, next time. I get that. A lot of people think, you know, as a small business owner myself, you know, oh, you own your own business. It's a piece of cake. You have all the free time in the world. But in reality, it just means you do every single job.
Wear a lot of hats.
Yeah. So we got a couple of questions in the chat. We'll just kind of throw in here. Jay wants to know, I'd like to hear about cover crops. If yes, what is the timeline? Do you do cover crops, Ron?
Sure, I do. I love cover crops. It's one of the worst things you can do is have a bare soil, because, you know, just erosion in the winter and nothing to hold, you know, your biology in place, especially the nutrients. Is, you know, we have sandy soil here, so things will leach rather quickly. So in the fall, I have plenty of time to get in a cover crop of winter rye. You know, in the springtime, a lot of people use, you know, I still continue with the winter rye. Matter of fact, I'll till just where the greenhouse is going to go, and I'll leave the winter rye all along the rest of the garden, because it's easy for me. Instead of laying boards down, I can walk in and out of the pack with no problems. And then, you know, a week or so before I remove the greenhouse, I'll till the winter rye. I'll have to mow it several times during the spring. It's a great food source for microbes too. In the springtime, a lot of growers, you know, use mustards or come right back with winter rye and stuff like that. I'm speaking for New England, because our weather is probably a lot different than some other areas that may be warmer. Cover crops is a big part of my rotation. When I'm resting a patch, I'll go with mustard as a cover crop, you know, as a biofumigant. I've also done African marigolds, which are about 4 foot high, which they're a great colonizer for biology, specifically mycorrhizal fungi. So, you know, I've done that. Zinnias look absolutely beautiful. I have a picture of them on my website. Zinnias are one of the number one colonizers we use to grow mycorrhizal fungi and stuff. So I do a lot of zinnias, and people really like them. Sometimes when they stop by, they can see the zinnias, and to see 5,000 square foot of zinnias growing, it's pretty amazing. So I do use that cover crop in the summer sometimes too. You know, I've done sun hemp and Sudan grass, which is another great, you know, colonizer to hold the soil in place too. But you really need some equipment to get those cover crops worked and tilled on, because even with my small tractor and tiller, that'll really beat you up working it under. So there's various cover crops out there that are all good. I'm a big fan of cover cropping. It should be part of any rotation.
Gotcha. That's a great information. Brad wants to know, what are your thoughts on Florel? I'm wondering how many growers use it. It seems to be the secret weapon. And I, along with Brad, I've heard some horror stories too. What do you think about juicing the plant, Ron, or juicing the pumpkin specifically?
Well, hey, everything's fair, you know, unless you're injecting the pumpkin with something. His thing with Florel, you know, I've spent a great part of this winter online looking at papers. I have the benefit of having a close personal friend who's a scientist, and he can read through that stuff obviously a lot better than me. And we're trying to find a connection of the active ingredient in Florel and just how it could provide for the pumpkin. Yes, I have used it the last couple of years because everybody seemed to be using it. I didn't seem to have any adverse effects from it. There's plenty of research online, if you Google Florel and Google the active ingredient, that they will, the scientific papers, you know, when you're, you know, getting a product like that and you're looking at scientific data that's been done to it, it's, you know, you would think it would be pretty legitimately, because the science has no horse in the race to sell a product or to do anything. there was that one article out there on tomatoes that was from 20 years ago that I think got everybody hooked on the Florel, because it showed on the tomatoes 48 hours after pollination that if you sprayed them with this 100 parts per million, that the tomatoes actually were a bigger size. The downside of that is there's never been any follow-up to that article in that almost 20 years. The articles I did find, or we did find on Florel this winter, show that in zucchini and summer squash, you know, first of all, it's tough to find things just on giant pumpkins because they're not a cash crop. But on zucchini and summer squash, there was an increase in plant yield, no doubt about it, because the Florel would produce more female flowers. But the individual size of the zucchini and summer squash were not increased. So I'm kind of on the fence whether there's true science behind it, that it can work as effectively as what everybody thinks it does. That's just my opinion. There is plenty of research online on Florel. All you have to do is Google it. Google the active ingredient in it, and you could read for days of, you know, how people are using it, applying it, and what their methods are for. On the other spectrum, there is enough really good data online too about, you know, cytokines and different things in combination that people have used in third world countries to increase fruit size, to increase, you know, crops, because they really depend on it to survive. There's some really good articles on these growth hormones and how successfully they've been used to increase crop yield of individual fruits and vegetables.
Oh, yeah, that's really fascinating stuff. But just, you know, a whole different level of depth that you get into when you talk about giving your plants hormones and stuff.
Yeah, I certainly wouldn't spray any of the Florel on the plant itself. I would just go by what everybody else has been doing with it. But I'm kind of on the fence after reading what I read this winter, whether I think it would help or not. Just my opinion.
Yeah. Next question is, how big do you think the ideal plant is? Benny Meyer, world record holder, what, maybe, I don't know, was he 5 or 6 years ago? He had relatively small plants. Travis has plants the size of an aircraft carrier. Do you think that there's an ideal plant size?
I think 800 to 1,200 square foot seems to be the sweet spot. You know, Ruben's been extremely successful with 2,500 pounds and 800 or so square foot. You know, Steve Deletis has been incredibly successful in, I think, close to 1,400 square foot. I've settled in around 1,250 square foot now because I knocked it down to a couple plants because I'm just too busy. So I don't do, you know, four or five plants anymore. Two plants is fine for me now just to compete and keep my feet wet in a hobby that I love. It seems like, you know, if the timing's right and the seed's right and everything's right, anywhere between 800 and 1,200 square foot. The reason I like a little bit more is if you lose a vine or two, or you have some issues, you have a little bit more plant left there. But you know, there's been really big pumpkins grown between 800 and 1,200 square foot or so. I think you can grow a world record between 800 and even, you know, 1,600 foot if you wanted to.
Nice. So you're saying I have a chance. In general, how did you get your start in giant pumpkin growing? What's Ron Wallace's origin story?
Well, my dad, I believe, was the first grower in New England to grow giant pumpkins. My dad comes from about 30 minutes from Buffalo, New York, and hence to know why everybody wants to know why I'm a Bills fan all the time. So when we were growing up, we had no choice. We were Bills fans. So, and, you know, Collins, New York, and upstate New York, and, you know, Nova Scotia with Howard Dill is where this all got going. So my dad had a little bit of exposure to it, but back in those days, there was really no information until Don Langevin's book came out. So my dad in the late 70s, early 80s was getting some seed when he went back home up in Collins from Ray Waterman, and he was doing it back here in Rhode Island. So I would help him. And, other than a couple hundred pounders, we could never figure it out. And so that's how I got my start. And then we stopped for a few years, and then Don Langevin's book came out, Somebody gave it to my dad as a Christmas gift. And I remember I read the whole thing on Christmas Day and I said, we got to give this thing another shot. And I think that was like 33 years ago or something like that. And we haven't stopped since. So that's how that was how I got introduced into the hobby.
That's awesome. And I want to take this opportunity to invite everybody to, number one, subscribe to this channel. We do lots of interviews and whatnot. Then also, if you could, Ron has an Instagram page and a Facebook page. Both of those handles are Wallace Wow. So if you're on the social medias, check those out. Ron does in-season posting. Not a super big poster because he is quite busy, but he does put out good content. And pretty much all content, if you really pay attention to it, there's nuggets in everything that you post. So do yourself a favor and check out Ron's social media.
Thanks. Hey, Chad, that's a good point you bring up, too. I'd like to tell everybody I have no secrets. I get a lot of questions. You know, you'd sell more if you posted more. Chad knows I've struggled with social media for years. It's just not my thing. And you can't be good at everything. And, you know, we're quite busy all the time. If anybody ever has a question, they can certainly email me at my email. It's on my site. Or send me a Facebook message. I'll answer every single question, every phone call, every day. That's what we do. No secrets here. It's just that I don't post a ton, and I'm going to try to do a little more just because of time frame, and you know, I've struggled with that.
That's one of my questions down the road, but we'll just cross that bridge right now. Is generally, you know, I'm sure there's busy times and slow times, but let's talk about in season. In season, how much time do you spend on customer service, answering emails, phone calls, text messages from the kid in Colorado, et cetera, et cetera?
It's ongoing. I mean, I wake up every day around 5 o'clock in the morning, and I generally don't stop till like 9:30, 10 o'clock at night. I'll be sitting there in a chair returning text messages and, you know, Facebook messages, Instagram, it's nonstop. It's every break. You know, as you know, when you run a small business that's growing, you need more people, which we have, and to supply some help. But I'm so tightly pulled into the brand where when, you know, my administrative assistant would answer the phone and try to help out, people would say, I want to talk to Ron. And that's one of the pluses of, you know, being tight to your brand. And so I do take that, you know, I do take every single call gets returned, every email. It's flattering, but it's a lot. So,
and I think that, you know, I know you wouldn't say these things, so I'm going to say them for you. It's really, you know, it's important to support the people who support the hobby. You know, Ron may sell a thing or two that you can find for 50 cents cheaper on Amazon, but when you got a question, are you going to be able to call up Jeff Bezos and ask those questions and get an email from, you know, the pumpkin champion, world record holder, three-time champion, GPC Hall of Fame member, Jeff Bezos? No, you know, you're not going to get squat. So go ahead, spend 50 cents more, support somebody who supports us, and then, you know, you can ask around all the questions you want, guilt-free, but don't waste Ron's time. That's my personal opinion, not Ron's. what's like your number one tip for somebody who's brand new growing giant pumpkins? You know, some kid who wants to do it. What's your number one tip?
Great point. Start with 150 square foot. I have directions for that on my website. Steve Connolly, you know, I think he grew just under 1,400 pounds at 150 square foot, which I find is absolutely amazing. What these growers are doing in 150 square foot is, you know, a tremendous contest for people. You know, if you have, you know, some kids or you're trying to get, you know, the attention span might not be there. A lot of people don't realize the work that gets involved with growing them. But in 150 square foot, anybody can find the time to manage that. And if you can get yourself a, you know, 400-500-pound, 300-pound pumpkin the first year, the biggest problem some people have when they email me is they can't figure out how to get it out of the garden and up near the front of the house. So I always tell them, start small. Do one or 250-square-foot plants. Get to learn how to bury a vine, how to get your garden fertilized and stuff like that. You know, just basic techniques. And then nobody really likes to spray their plant. So a lot of times, sometimes they can get lucky for a year or two without much, you know, fungicides. But You know, I always try to tell them there's some basic fungicides that you can get at a box store. You're going to have to do something at some point, but start small. That I think that 150 square foot is perfect for anybody starting out in the hobby.
That's a great tip, Ron. We'll take a few questions from the chat now. Growing Giants with Scott wants to know, are you using one of those products such as Oxidate or TerraClean since you're not rotating this year?
Yes, I used it in the fall. I think the Oxidate and the TerraClean, I think they're both the same label now. The labels have been changed on them, and I forget the exact name. And they have two different formulations. It's the one with the higher parasitic acid, I believe I'm pronouncing that properly, is the one I used because that's really what's doing the trick in these soil fumigations. I did that in the fall, and I took a soil test in the fall. I sent it to Harry at Weston Labs. The Weston Labs, another great company to deal with there. You can get the owner of the lab on the phone to speak with you about your soil report. That's invaluable to me. And then in the disease side of it, Harry, who's been with them forever, is a great pathologist. And he calls me. I'll network with him on water testing and, you know, disease. So I took a disease sample in the fall. And yeah, I kind of knew what I was looking at. And so I treated in the fall. I'm going to go back and treat again in the spring. And then I'm going to wait about a month because if you are testing, you can't test right away because the DNA is going to be picked up as both live and dead. So we want the bad guys to kind of fully dissolve in the soil. So I'm going to wait about probably 5 weeks. I'm going to send another test in. And I'm going to see just how this product worked. But yes, I did use it. I recommend, I have a very good respirator I use. You know, I use a very good outfit when I'm spraying this stuff. I know the label says you can do this, 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 and that with it, but I don't want to be inhaling that stuff. And so I would recommend suiting up when you're applying it.
I was going to echo that. I'm a man of like putting my shirt over my nose, and I got some of that splashed on my fingers. It bleached my fingers.
Yeah, so. Don't do that. Go get yourself a good respirator, a good mask and good thing to use. I used to be like you. I'd run out there, shorts on and a t-shirt, and they'd blow back in your face. Not anymore.
And I will say I did use that product myself. I did it in the springtime. And then all season, I did a fall, maybe 2 months ago, I did a soil test, a pathogen test, and my disease counts were significantly less even after a whole season of growing. So I'm going to basically do exactly what you're going to do. If Ron's doing it, it's good enough for me.
Yeah, it's reasonable, too. I think the product's reasonable for that 2.5-gallon jug.
Yeah. Brad wants to say thanks for answering the questions, not to mention all the great products that I purchased from him. So thank you.
Thanks, Brad. Thanks for your support, you and everyone else. Thank you.
Jay, how do you deal with the squash vine borer, the dreaded squash vine borer? I lost my giant last year, and I think I want to use systemic treatment, but I'm unaware of a product and application method. I know Ron knows the answer to this one.
Sure. Well, every 3 weeks I use Merit in my program because, specifically I use Merit. It's systemic. It's an aphid killer. And what I found is best to work with aphids. So I always have a contact and a systemic going. So the systemic would be the Merit. And the contact is a Warrior T label. I know that's the active ingredient in that is also under 3 or 4 different labels that you could get probably cheaper. I'm trying to think of the trade name for that it goes by, but the Warrior T was, I had purchased it with a few growers about 4 years ago, and we bought so much of it. So I do that weekly. And as soon as I see the first cucumber beetle, which could be anywhere in May, it could be the middle of June. As soon as I see the first cucumber beetle, I start the every 7 days with the Warrior. And then every 3 weeks or so, I'll mix a Merit in with that. So I have a contact answer. And the Merit does hang around a bit in your plant, and it moves north, south, east, and west in the plant. So it's sort of like a double-pronged approach that has worked well for us. But once you have them, then you're in trouble. So you got to really stay on top of them. A lot of people use lures to know when they're in the area. Well, I'll let other growers tell me when they're in the area. I'm not a big believer in those pheromone traps because I feel if they're not positioned properly, they bring them to your property. I could be wrong. It's just my feelings on them, but I do have friends who have them, so they'll alert me that they're in the area, and we've had good success treating like that.
It's a good one. Thankfully, we don't have those over here. This is a good one. This one, I'm looking forward to hearing your thoughts on this. But specifically, what are your thoughts on weed fabric and perhaps vine burying and lack thereof? There's been a lot of success with people not burying vines as of late.
Well, I'm a vine burier. My good friend Dave Steltz doesn't really bury vines, and he's one of the best in the world. I go back and forth with them and say, Dave, I think if you would have buried vines last year, you would have had two or three, 2,500 pounders. I think it's worth something. I think that top tap root is worth something. It should be buried. Once again, just my opinion. I know one grower uses all weed mat, I think in Kansas, who's done really, really well. And I forget his name right now, but
Jacob.
Yes, it's been a lot of success with growers who Joe Jutras kind of tried the weed mat one year and then poked holes in it and did that. That was kind of a lot of work. And, being outdoor growers, like I am too, I need stability. If I get wind, I really got to make sure that plant is anchored. So there has been, I think you'd have a lot less disease issues if you didn't bury, because if these vines were meant to grow underground, they would. So I think that's a benefit of not burying. But as far as the stability of the plant, I really believe in that top tap root, and it helps anchor the plant in place. So, there's more than one way to get this done. There's not one fertilizer, one program, one method. As you can see, the growers, a lot of people have been successful using different variations and different methods. People just have to try things to see if it works for them. Hey, if I didn't have to bury a vine and you just positioned it and laid out, it'd be a lot less work, that's for sure. But it's something I feel is necessary.
Yeah, for sure. And speaking of the Kansas guy, he asks, wow, what are one or two new things that you want to try this year?
One or two new things that I'm going to try this year. I really tried last year. Last year, I really was more of a systemic approach with, I'm going to measure every, me and Chad have had this conversation before. I tell growers, I had this conversation today with somebody. Hey, how much do I use? Well, everybody should pick up an EC meter. There's really expensive ones. There's dirt cheap ones. There's some in the middle. Get an EC meter. Find out, what you're fertilizing at and what seems to work for you. And, just from a water pH standpoint, I know several growers who never knew what their water pH was until a year or two ago. And now they've adjusted that, and they've significantly added to the weights of their pumpkins by making sure the pH of the feed was correct. So I was really a stickler last year with, everything was, metered in measurements to parts per million. So a lot of those things I did last year, and I saw very good results from that, is kind of what I implied last year. I'm trying to think, I have a couple of other new biologicals that I'm going to be working, into the program and stuff, just to add a little more, diversity from a bacillus standpoint. I'm trying to think of other things. I mean, like I was showing Chatter, this is my kind of notebook of stuff that I work on in the off season. There's like a ton of things on there. I am going to balance my cobalt in my soil, my molybdenum, which there's a lot of really good articles on there. Some of these really, really micronutrients that we've never really tested for. Or when it shows up on the test is non-detectable, we never really give it much thought. But some of these really can significantly add some weight and some different things to our plants. So I'm going to pay a little bit more attention to that this year and adjust accordingly in the beginning of the season. I'm going to get a little more copper into my program this year, systemic copper. I still have some Phyton 27. I believe they changed the name on that. And I've had some issues in the last couple of years. And I think, you know, I'm going to add a little more copper back into my program for disease suppression. I'm also going to go with drip irrigation, my first time ever doing that. I'm a hand watering guy. I spend a lot of time on my hands and knees watering underneath the plant, but I think I'm going to go with drip irrigation because, you know, talking to some growers over the years, it seems like there's been a lot of success with the connection of growers who are watering multiple times a day, either morning and afternoon, morning, noon, and afternoon. So I'm going to do that. I'm also I'm actually going to put them online soon. I have a tour coming up in a couple of weeks in Cape Cod with the manufacturers of Hobo Onset meters. So it's a soil meter, sort of similar to what Pete Caspers has been using. Charlie Bernstrom used this meter that I'm going to use this year. He used it last year, so he always knew what his soil moisture was and would adjust his water accordingly to that. And so I'm going to be doing that this year, but I've got to, that way it'll also tell me my soil EC at the same time. So generally when my soil EC gets up around 1, then I can start to see some issues. The plant will get brittle, it's too much, I'll have to back off. So so now I'll have a probe in the ground and that will tell me the moisture, it will tell me the EC. So something like that, I just think as much control as you can get and consistency seems to be a real key. Obviously, if we have the ability with some of these instruments now to be more consistent, I think it will only help us in the end.
And I will throw out, it was Charlie is the grower you're talking about who is now pHing the soil. And I'm looking at tools.pumpkinfanatic.com, our first interview. And Charlie's personal best was 2501 in 2003. His previous personal best was in 2020 at 1990. So then fast forward 3 years, his new personal best was 2131 and then 2500. So he improved, you know, we'll call it 500 pounds with the help of pHing water, which is, I got this here product from a website called wallacewow.com. It's a Hannah checker of all of those things. So if you want one of those, go to wallacewow.com. let's see here. Also, don't forget, Ron's going to donate some seeds and some products at the end, so stay tuned. We got 51 people. We've been bouncing around between 40 and 50 people. John, Jason's text messaging me, telling me that, so that's really cool. That's the most we've ever had because Ron is a rock star. What are the most common mistakes that you see growers do, be it beginner or veteran growers? What's kind of some of the mistakes that you see?
Starting plants too early is common with, you know, with newer growers, setting fruit, you know, setting that first fruit out of the gates that's really close to the base of the plant, which is too close. And, you know, my minimum now is like, I won't take anything before 12 foot. Seems like 15 foot seems to be the sweet spot for me. But when you're setting a fruit really close, and a lot of newer growers do that, they're all excited, they want to set the fruit. Well, it really deters the structure of the plant being set up. So I see that a lot. Overwatering, and I've been guilty of that, and over fertilizing, I've been guilty of that too in the past. So I think those things right there are some of the common mistakes we've all made.
So that's a good segue into some other questions I had kind of lined up. So the two questions specifically were when to start the seeds and how old, in your opinion, is the ideal age to harvest your fruit? So, like, how long do we want a pumpkin to grow? You know, rule of thumb is 100 days, and then you kind of get into the danger zone. But what do you think those dates are? Where should we be starting the seed, kind of timeline on setting a pumpkin, and how old should it be? Because if we know how old the pumpkin should be, we can kind of reverse math all that.
Well, I generally, around the, you know, where we live here, anywhere from the 10th to 15th of April seems to be a good time to start up. You know, I've got some indoor grow lights, the greenhouse is up, we'll move them outside to get a little natural sun. By the by the third week of April or the first of May, they're in the ground and ready to go. And, you know, we're fortunate to have several way-offs throughout New England, some early ones, some later ones that we could take it to. But it would, a lot would depend on your area and your climate, on the starting date. The pumpkin, these pumpkins have shown now that they can grow 120 days. The longer the better. I found some of my heaviest pumpkins are the ones that really crept and went slow for the last 3 weeks. I think as many days, you got to get at least 100 days out of them, 100 plus days. And, you know, here's the thing. If the pumpkin's healthy, you know, I've had them, you know, sit here till Thanksgiving, and then you have to get the seeds out of them. And then, you know, sometimes they don't make it. And then, yeah, they really, you just never know how long a pumpkin's going to last. But I definitely say a minimum, you know, 100 to 115, 20 days would really be nice if you could time it out that way.
Wow. Okay. So longer than I've ever grown a pumpkin. I might have to make that change this year. Yeah. Do you think that 3,000 pounds will happen this year?
No, probably not this year. But maybe. I mean, I think the ones who would have the best shot at doing that would be, you know, Ian and Stuart. You know, they're that good. And you know, they've got a controlled environment. And, you know, Joe Jutras has a really nice professional greenhouse now. And he's figured out a few things over the last year or two that I could see somebody like that giving it a run for sure, because I just think that the greenhouse grow up, when it hits, and, you know, not all seeds are the same. When you get that right seed and it hits, and then you combine that with good weather conditions, well, in September, when we're all struggling, or when we get those 2-3 inch rain episodes, and in the greenhouse you're shedding that, and you can get the nighttime temperatures better, you can control the daytime temperatures a bit better. When you get that combination that works well with that greenhouse, I think you can put substantial distance on somebody who's going outdoors.
Nice.
Joe, you saw it, 2,900 pounds. I mean, that's almost 200 pounds bigger than anything that's ever been grown. And hadn't split on them, they were probably looking at another 75 pounds or so. So that'll just show you, in the right hands, in the right conditions, you know, what you can do. But can an outdoor grower do it? Heck yeah. I mean, look what Travis is doing. You know, outdoor growers can do it too. I just think,
yeah, I'm always surprised at that.
I just think when the environment is right and the conditions are right, a greenhouse grower could smack it way over the fence.
And Joe was telling me and showing me pictures of his greenhouse last year at the big show, and
it's incredible.
Really cool. He has an A+ setup. I'm looking forward to seeing what he grows.
Joe's a builder. I mean, everything he does is architecturally amazing. So it's a great greenhouse.
So you kind of touched on it a little bit, but the next question is, what is that seed? What's the hot seed? What are you growing? What seed is going to grow the 3,000-pound pumpkin this year if it happens?
I don't know. I think the genetics might have been made last season for the 3,000-pounder. I mean, obviously, the number one seed in the world is the Andean, 2365. I mean, it's unbelievable. I still have one, and if it germinates, it'll go in. I like the genetics that were done last year. I mean, Travis's cross is interesting because you had big and big on both sides of it. I think anything crossed with the Andes, and I like that 1707 Caspers into it. I like that genetic line a lot. It might not have panned out for the 1707 last season, but I think the crosses made with that into that 2365. That's why I think my 2344 holes, on paper, to me, it looks as good as anything that's out there. The thing about the hobby over the last, you know, 5 or 6 years is really not just one seed anymore that everybody needs. You look at that top 20, and there's a lot of different seeds in there now. The genetics are just so good on all of them. You just kind of got to get fortunate, get the right one, get the one that wants to go in the right shape. There's a lot of good crosses done last year, but I think, you know, obviously Andy seed is going to be in something that grows 3,000 pounds.
Okay. So let's see here. Riviera, great tip, love the zinnias. TH, do you feel that winter rye leaves a cleaner patch free of weed pressure when you start?
Yeah, for the first few weeks. But, yeah, you know, weeds are another thing that we kind of talk about all the time. You know, getting back, you know, might have skipped over when you mentioned early about growing over the mill fabric and stuff. I know a lot of growers notice I have a strip of mill fabric that goes down my main vine. I just cut a hole in the bottom for the bottom tap root. And I make little sandbags, little glad bags with some play sand in it. And I inoculate my top tap root and I put that over the top to keep the roots nice and dark. In about 3 or 4 days, that top tap root will hit the sandbag and head down into the soil. I do that, Matt, underneath the main vine, just because I want to keep that main vine elevated. So I don't, it's really helped keeping a cleaner main vine, because without a main vine, you can't grow pumpkin. So I had a note here that I didn't fully answer that earlier. It's great because I never really have to go up to that main vine and weed. That weed block right there locks the weeds out. It'll let the moisture or the nutrients through. So the fertilizer and the rainfall or my watering will work. But to deal with it over a whole patch, it would be very difficult, in my opinion, you know, seeing what somebody I know went through. So the weeds with the rye are great for the first 3 weeks. But if you've been growing in the same patch, the weeds are coming back. And, you know, I know some growers have been successful using preen. You know, I've looked into that. It looks like, at the end of the day, it looks like a lot of kitty litter spread out over the top of the patch. I can't sure. I don't know what the cost of that is, but growers have had success using it. I looked into it a little bit this winter, but I didn't. There's also some pre-emergent stuff, talking to Joe Eltz, that they use in soybean and corn and that. But I got to look at the labels that they say you get a 6 to 7 week time frame out of it. Joe kind of thought that was generous, but it might be something I may try before I take my greenhouse down, my outside area, just to try to, you know, because the weeds are an issue and you're in there trampling up, so you're compacting soil. I try to stay on a board in between each vine. And then when you're pulling weeds up, you're also disturbing hair roots. It goes hand in hand. You obviously, you're pulling some roots up too. So it is an issue. Don't know if I have the answer for it. You know, but, you know, cover crops, they will help a bit on the weeds, but not for long.
Interesting. I will have to, you know, keep in touch with you about that, because I thought about using a pre-emergent myself, and I just, It makes me a little nervous. I won't lie. Throwing all that stuff down when you're trying to, you know, encourage root growth and development, and, you know, that stops it. So we'll follow up on that one with you. So I think now would be a good time maybe to have everybody enter their number for the giveaway. So, Ron, will you tell us what you are going to donate to the viewers today?
Sure. I can do like 3 sets of what, you know, what I had out here last year. We had 2344.5. We also had a 1950 off of the Casper 1707. And then my dad had a 1907 that was unofficial that unfortunately got a soft spot and went down before the weigh-off. That was grown in 396 square foot, which is amazing. And he just used my starter packs on him for fertilizer because, you know, he's 82 years old and he's not, he said it was going to be a relaxed method last year. And with his relaxed method, he was, you know, making a run at 2,000 pounds and just under 400 square foot. So it was great pumpkin too.
Okay, so we got three sets of Ron seeds. So how we do this, everybody, is you're going to pick a number. We have 56 people in right now, so we'll do 70. Pick a number 1 through 70. Police the chat. Don't double up the numbers, and then put your email next to that so that if you win, Jason will be able to email you, because some of you, we don't know who you are specifically or how to get a hold of you, because I can't send you a message through Facebook. Yeah. So you pick a number. I will throw it into the random number generator. And, whoever wins.
Chad, I also have, you can also do, let's do 3 of the 1-pound bags of the premium mycorrhizal inoculant and 3 bags of my 24-count super starter pack. So if you want to do some product in there separate to stretch out the raffle or add them in with seeds, whatever you want to do.
Oh, man. So we have 3 seeds. So we have 9 numbers. So nine people will get product. I picked number 24. Nobody else picked 24. So thanks so much, Ron, for that. We will pick those numbers at the end, so stay tuned at the end. Again, we need a number in your email or a method to get a hold of you. I will put those numbers 75 in the random number generator, and we'll pick those numbers. So keep on watching till the end. Jump back over to kind of the questions that we have gathered. Ron, do you use heating cables in the springtime?
Yes, I do. I just use the standard 24-foot heating cables to get the plant off to a good start. You know, they do a great job. You know, I just use the ones that I have on my website. You know, you got to be careful digging them up, you know, at the end of the year. They're not ones that you can just pull up from the cord and rip them out of the soil. But I've used the same ones for 3 or 4 seasons. I'll test them every year to make sure that thermostat and they're good to go. So I found that, you know, if you get your greenhouse up early, like we do, the soil's going to naturally start to warm and heat up. And, you know, by the time, you know, those roots are outside that 24-foot heating area, I have a couple of pictures, I think, on the website on the heating cables where it shows the kind of the pit that I've dug to put it in, that the rest of the soil warms up rather quickly in a 20x40 polytunnel. So it's just used to get that initial seedling off to a good start. And then inside that greenhouse, once it gets rocking, you can tell the plant will stop moving. Hey, Chad, I think your mic's off.
Yes, it is. My children are being little kids, so I'm trying to mute in between questions so we don't have the screaming of youngsters. So, Rob, do you sandbag around? Are you a sandbagger?
No, absolutely not. You know something? Absolutely not. I'm brought up with the utmost integrity. That comes from my dad and my mom. And always, you know, once again, my friends, people email me all the time during the season. Where are you at? What are you doing? You know, I just tell them straight out where I'm at. I'm not a big poster of how many inches I got and this and that. I just, you know, I don't post it. You know, I worked in the golf course industry. I hung around with enough sandbaggers, and we used to have a saying, you learn a lot about somebody when you play with them on the golf course, okay? So I've always held myself to a higher standard of, I don't see in deceiving anybody. I don't know what people get out of that. Few growers locally who do that, they'll show up 20, 30 inches bigger. You know, the scale is what everybody tells them who wins, who loses, and it's all about having fun and competing. And so no, I'm not a sandbagger. Yeah, I play it tight to the vest, but I don't post a ton of pictures of my pumpkins and weights because I don't enter weigh-offs to win money. I really love the ribbons. I love the camaraderie. I love to grow. It pushes me. It pushes the hobby. Where else can you watch something do 50 pounds a day? So, and the competitions out here in the Northeast, there's really not a lot of people who are just eyeballing weigh-offs because they pay so many dollars a pound. We're not in a huge agricultural industry, so you're not getting those massive payouts and stuff like that. But, you know, so, you know, around here, you don't get that like you might get in some other areas.
I've really noticed that. You guys, in your Rhode Islandish area, you're always helping each other. It seems like you help each other put up your greenhouses. You guys go in on buys on expensive products that you only need a little bit of. It seems like you guys have a really cool dynamic back there.
Yeah. Nobody does anything alone. You know, when somebody grows a giant pumpkin, or somebody does any accomplishes anything, they've had help along the way from friends, from family, from growers. The camaraderie that our club has and in New England is kind of unmatched because we help each other. I mean, Steve Sperry won the weigh-off this year, and he was a grower of the year. We could not have been more happy. There's a guy who's taken kind of a backseat to me and Joe for a long time, and it was as good, if not a better grower. And it finally happened for him. We could not have been more proud of him for what he did. And you come to our weigh-off, there's no jealousies amongst the growers. All of our directors and the growers who compete, there's really everybody's happy for each other. We really don't run into that people pulling up with a minute to the weigh off with a bigger pumpkin, and that stuff sort of doesn't happen out this way.
That's so cool. Which is, you know, a good lead into the next question. Do you have anyone that you want to thank, any growers or somebody specific that's really been a rock star and helped you out over, you know, your time as a giant?
It all starts with my dad. I mean, he was reading, getting books from the library back in the 80s on cytokines and growth hormones and trying to study how to grow a bigger pumpkin. So that's who really got it going. But, you know, I was fortunate to have John Castellucci, a late great John Castellucci, who started the Rhode Island Giant Pumpkin Growers, was a wonderful, generous gentleman who gave us all fertilizers, seeds, plants. He helped us get going because he had a really good gardening background. And then the late great Hugh Weiberg and Wayne Hackney, they were all instrumental. Tony Siliberto, Don Black. You know, those guys were the originals in the beginning when there was no nothing. And then Don Landgren. I've become really good friends with Don Landgren. And until Don's book come out, none of us knew anything. Don took basic information from a lot of growers and put it on paper. So now we had the ability to compete. I mean, Don really took layoffs from weighing in parking lots to mainstream because the book had so much success and it put growing on a level playing field for that time when it came out. So all of those growers in the beginning, they're kind of like the founding fathers around here in New England who gave their time and their information, whatever they knew, they said generously in their seeds. And that's what I try to do to this day, is to follow in their footsteps and give back to the community and give back to growers.
Well, that's awesome, Rob. We all very much appreciate it. So you touched on it earlier, and this is one that I really find fascinating, and it definitely falls into the, you know, there's many ways to skin a cat. So specifically, when we're talking like, you know, the EC meters, PPM meters, when we're going for feeding, how hot do we want the mixture? I know, you know, I've gone up to 2, and I think, you know, you're more of a low dose kind of guy, maybe a 0.5 EC or so. Mm-hmm. You know, what are your thoughts on just feeding? How heavy should we be feeding?
I tell you that's a question I can tell you what I do. I think that when growers go along and using a meter in conjunction with their soil, they'll figure out something that seems to work. And your plant's always going to tell you. If you've been growing these for a while, you look at the plant, you can tell the color, the drive. You can kind of tell when they need a boot in the ass and when they need something else. I read it in pots per million. I know it's old school instead of going, you know, EC, but I still go by pots per million. And I found when the vines were running, now you remember, I converted to rainwater and reverse osmosis water last year because I think, you know, Chad, we talked about this. My well ended up getting contaminated probably back 5-6 years ago, and I never knew it. It was so high in sodium from an aquifer, and I was never in the loop, but I had a lot of issues for 5 or 6 years, and then finally, thankfully, figured it out. So last year, I went specifically with rainwater and filtered reverse osmosis water. And so I'm starting really low at like 60 parts per million on my water. You know, sometimes it's near zero. A lot of benefits to that because the rainwater is very soft. That's why your plants grow so good when it rains. So if you have the ability to catch rainwater, it really helps because, and I got a lot of these tips. A lot of the products I sell are popular in the cannabis industry, and a lot of the growers who grow mainstream cannabis, they were the first ones. They're like us. They are really dialed in on EC, PPM, you know, water quality is huge with cannabis growers. And I've listened to a few friends of mine who grow commercially who would say, hey, we got to start checking out your water. We got to do this. We got to do that. And they were exactly right. I think at the least you should know what your pH is, your water, and what your parts per million are. Because my regular house well water was starting at almost 400 parts per million. Well, you really couldn't put much fertilizer in that because you'd be through the roof. And then it was contaminated with sodium. So backing it all up, I went with that system last year. So my water is starting very low. Having said that, I was around 500 to 550 parts per million was my daily feed. When the vines were running, I could go up to 700, 750 with no issues. in the fruit set, I was around 500 to 5.25 pots per million all the way up until the end of the first week of September. And then I started backing it down each day. Now, so it's kind of low, but you remember I'm starting out near zero. So if your average water is starting out at 150, 175 pots per million, I'm actually adding another 150 pots per million of fertilizer. But I'm starting with water that has no nutrients in it. So everything I add is what I know that plant needs. So I can switch up my formula based on soil or tissue test. So I really getting dialed in as to feeding like that. And the plants and the pumpkins took it. When I noticed when the vines were running, if they got a little brittle and I had a vine break, I knew, and I would check my soil and see I was getting a little too hot, I would back off. When you use biologicals, and I use biologicals a couple times a week, that really does not move the EC meter, which is great. So if your soil's getting a little hot, you can back off for 2 or 3 days with the biologicals. And on my meter, that wasn't even 100 pots per million. So you just, you weren't adding a lot of salt concentrations or anything. So that number seemed to work for me. It may be too low for some other people, and it may be too high for some people. You really have to figure out, because if you have a lot of organic matter in your soil, once that soil gets up to temp, it's going to start mineralizing. And when it starts mineralizing, you're going to get nitrogen, specifically nitrate. So having said that, you can't turn that off. That's why I backed off on adding lots of compost and manures over the last 4 or 5 years, because when it was good, it was good. When it turned on and you couldn't shut it off, it was like a runaway freight train. That's why I got to go more daily feeding.
Wow, that's real good stuff. And on that note too, like, how frequently are you feeding?
Every day. Pretty much every day. We had a lot of rain last year. We had record rainfall last year. So I went some days, 2-3 days without watering, 4 days. We were getting rain 2-3 inches at a time. When we had stretches that didn't rain, I was fertilizing every day, every single day. Me and Steve Sperry kind of do the same, program. And we're feeding every day. And I got to, this is from networking with growers, and I picked up on this because Barry LeBlanc, kind of took me under his wing with his fertilization methods. He waters out of river water and stuff, which is a real low EC and stuff. And he got, he worked with Steve Geddes for years, and Steve's published articles on a newsletter on his, half a cup per plant and pot per million, all of that. And that was all really good information. And, we kind of adopted, a good percentage of that and put it in our patches the last couple of years. And we've seen that, you can have a steady hand, going to the plants and give them what they want.
That's great. Asking for a friend, somebody posted this, I don't know who, but when it comes to diseases, specifically Fusarium and Pythium, what are your favorite methods for battling those diseases? Somebody not me asked that question.
Yeah, I had those issues myself too, but they say the Ritam, I use Subdue and Ritamil Gold are basically the same products, but the Ritamil Gold is a lot higher concentration of the active ingredient. The one thing I was tipped off on this year is I was talking to somebody, the manufacturer of the product said you really should do that pre-plant, and I didn't think it had the ability to blow up those water moles, those cells in the soil pre-plant. I thought they had to be attached to the root, and they said, no, absolutely not. I got that same information. Last week, I did a Zoom meeting. As a bunch of us, we do Zoom meetings every week, me, Dave Stelz, Steve Belitis, Don Young, and a bunch of us. We have growers come in every week and talk to us. We had Charlie Bernsterman last week, and he did the same thing, and he got his information from potato farmers. It's an old school product, but it works real well, and he did it pre-plant, then did it monthly. Phosphites help, oxytrobins help a lot, so you really want to have, I think the Ritamil Gold is a group, I think they're group 4 or group 11, and they can build up resistance. So that's why you want to have another group mixed in with them when you're treating, so you don't build up resistance to them. But, the Pythium has been an issue for me too. Pythium loves water. So when you get a lot of heavy rain like we did last year, you're going to have issues with that. So that's in the fusarium and stuff. You know, you really can't. You can treat for it, but I don't know how successful anything is. There is fusarium in every soil, every garden soil. If you've grown tomatoes for more than 1 year, you have fusarium. The only thing is these lab tests can't tell you if the fusarium you have in your soil will it affect cucurbits. Some of them will touch this crop, some will touch others. Some of the fusarium that you have in there won't bother your plants. These labs don't have that DNA ability at this time to tell you you have this specific strain and yes, you have an issue with it.
Gotcha. Great stuff, Ron. Now too, let's remind everybody, we have 63 viewers in here. subscribe to the channel, go to wallacewow.com. Ron has Instagram, Facebook, YouTube. Make sure to follow those too. Pick a number between 1 through 75, and then at the end of the stream, we're going to put those numbers into the random generator. Ron is donating product as well as his three-peat of seeds from last year. Super-duper generous, so police yourself. Somebody was correcting me. I had to pick three numbers before I found one that was available because I want some of that Wallace goodness myself. We have a handful of questions left. We're going to start to transition into, I want to ask Ron some specific questions about his business, and then we'll jump back over to the questions that you guys have in the chat. Last kind of normal question, Ron, is what is your goal for 2024?
My goal is always personal best. And I love to compete, want to grow another world record again, and I know I can do it. Only growing a couple of plants now, so it kind of narrows my chances down, but I'm also giving the plants more attention and care. Like, you're easier to pick up on things when you're not doing four plants or so. So personal best is always a good start, but world record is definitely always is always the goal. And just love pushing myself and pushing a hobby forward to see how big we can get them.
That's great. So let's jump into some questions. What is your best advice on reducing aborted fruit within the first week? Temperature?
Yeah, I found that when we've had issues with them, it was because, a couple of things, and mostly the environmental conditions. It was really, kind of cool and a lot of heavy rain, or rain the day that, that we pollinated, we would have issues, or if it was really warm. Thankfully, the giant pumpkins, they're pretty easy to pollinate. But, I would just think, try to, a lot of growers put ice if it's really hot and fans. And, a couple of really warm days, I've had a little fan 5-6 foot away just, blowing out on low. I don't know if it's done anything. I've protected them, obviously, if it was going to rain. I found if plants were bloated and there was a lot of nitrate, nitrogen, you would have issues with aborting too. I would say, kind of watch the fertilizer, but I don't stop. I mean, the old thing was, during pollination and during the first 10 days, everybody stopped fertilizing. I don't think anybody does that anymore. Everybody's just rolling right through. So just be careful of a few things like that.
Okay. We answered Brad's question earlier. He said, thanks. We got another one. You answered that. You do use heating cables. How big of an area and perhaps how deep do you like to bury your heating cables?
Well, my heating cable is probably 16, 18 inches deep. I bury it probably a little deeper than it should. It's probably, say 5x8, 5x6 or 7 area that it's in. It's just enough to get, it's 24 foot. Sounds like a lot, but when you take a grid and lay out, and I think I have a picture on my website where the heating cables are listed of the grid or how they're in soil. You think 24 foot's a lot, but when you put that kind of close and you put it in an area, it just really to get that first, 4 foot of the main vine and few feet of the side vine. Get that surrounding temperature up to speed, because there's nothing worse than putting a transplant in a cool soil. It's not going to move. I don't care what fertilizer you put on or what you do. I don't care what the temp is inside the greenhouse. If the soil is not warm, the plant's not going to grow.
Yeah. For sure. wife's leaving, so fair warning, if you hear chaos in the background, my kids are just, you know, asserting dominance. So we'll figure it out. Lance has a good question. What is your thoughts on terminating the main vine after the pumpkin? The method Moby Mike has made popular. I've done it. I like it. What do you think about it?
Yeah, I tell you, it's great for stress. You don't certainly don't have any stress. I've done it a couple times here. You know, once again, like everything else, there has been giant pumpkins grown on different methods. There's been a tremendous amount of success with everybody just taking the main vine, cutting a little vine at the stem, swinging the main vine, and, you know, maybe running a pitchfork off of that, or just turning the main vine and running it long. That's predominantly how most of those big ones have been, you know, most of the pumpkins have been grown. But there's been growers who have ended it right at the pumpkin and had success. I think depending on the area you're growing in, your space, you know, me, if I get a short stem like I had a few years ago and I have no choice and I know I'm going to battle it all year, I'm going to cut it right at the pumpkin because I think that's the best thing for me to do. If I have the normal size stem or anything, I'm keeping the main because to me, a couple of things I've noticed when they're growing, especially late in the season, it seems like sometimes when that main vine's creeping along or I have those side vines, I do believe that the side vines before the main are helping to produce the bigger pumpkin. I think any of that growth, as long as it's still growing, the pumpkin's a sink and it's going to take from all areas. But I do believe in swinging the main vine and then running two or three vines off of that like a pitchfork to fill the rest of that garden spot. So to me, I'm a main vine keeper. But once again, depending on the situation, I can switch. And a lot of, you know, there's been some really big pumpkins grown and ending it at the main.
Gotcha. So Pumpkin Jason says, Ron is the man. Brad agrees, customer service is amazing. Doc, I like to read, thank you note in the receipt and Ron's accent.
Through chat tonight, we can't do anything about the New England accent. I get a lot of times people think I was actually in the filming of The Sopranos. I'm not. It's just the New England accent, specifically the Rhode Island accent. And yes, we take a lot of pride, Doc, in hand signing every single invoice that goes out of here. You know, it's my way, you know, and believe me, there's some days where I'm sitting here signing for a long time and my shipper will be shipping and someone else will be pulling products to pack. And I've been asked many times, why do you still do that? No one does that anymore. Amazon doesn't do it. Matter of fact, most companies don't even put a packing slip in anymore because they're saving ink. I said, well, we're still small business. We do things kind of the old fashioned way. And that's one little thing that we really do appreciate the support we receive from growers. It means a lot to me and, you know, the people who I'm working with. So we'll always will continue to sign our packing slips.
Right. Forget about it. Let's see here. Eli, when do we break 3,000 pounds and who is it going to be? You kind of answered this earlier, probably maybe the Peyton Brothers and the ultra high tech greenhouse.
I think we're probably a few years away, maybe. You know, we're at that point now where a normal world record generally goes up, you know, 50 or so pounds a year on the normal bell curve, unless you get an outliner that blows it away by 200-300 pounds, like happened a few years ago, and it took 3 or 4 years to catch it. Mm-hmm. There's so many good growers nowadays. I mean, Ian and Stewart go to the top of my list, and then obviously Travis, because he's on a heck of a roll. And then Joe Jutris, Don Young, they got great greenhouses now. They're great growers. I mean, there's so many growers now. You know, look what Charlie Bertram did last year, you know.
Right.
So you really, to narrow it down, is probably a grower that we've never really heard much of in the last couple of years who could do it too. The information's out there. People are willing to help each other. So kind of tough to pigeonhole it down to a few, but
yeah. So let's see here. We got docks in the house, 150 square feet. Great place to start. True. Frank wants to know, can you talk about your watering system if you haven't already? Do you get new pumps this season? Did you get new pumps this season? Question mark.
Hi, Frank. Well, I talked a little bit about the water, and I went to RO water, which is reverse osmosis, which basically takes all the impurities. You know, I think a lot of people know what that is, but if you don't, you can Google search RO. But if you have the ability to catch some rainwater, it is, you know, paint the tank black, or and actually on Amazon, they sell those black coverings that go over those 275-gallon square tanks that you find on Facebook Marketplace or Craigslist for dirt cheap. So yeah, rainwater, I found, is very good to use, especially with my poor water quality. I will be going to drip irrigation this season. So I do have a one horsepower pump. I have a couple of them. I have to really figure out. Me and Alex Noel are going to work on the drip irrigation, put the header board in, and see just what I need for zones and how much of a pump I need to run it, because that'll be new to me. I'm sure it'll be aggravating. But I hand-watered last season. I've always hand-watered. I like keeping things off the leaves. Other than some contacts and systemics, I like to keep fertilizers and things off the leaves. I found it kept the plant looking a lot better. You know, when you water underneath the plant, you know, you really get a total root zone. You know, you don't get a lot of dry spots. And I kind of like that versus going over the top. But once again, that's just me. Some people have gone over the top. It funnels right down to the root, and they've grown world records. So, yeah. Once again, there's so many different ways to achieve success.
Okay. Do you think that vines pass the pumpkin back feed? I think you answered that. Yes.
Yeah, I think, you know, I think the pumpkin's a sink, and it'll take it from every place that it can. I wish we really knew how they fed and if they back fed, you know, because if they didn't, we would have a lot less work. We'd all be growing 600 square foot and ending at the pumpkin. Yeah. But I do think it's worth something. And, you know, so I'll continue to do it.
So kind of another question. Are you deadheading the main vine after the pumpkin? Ron said, not if he can help it.
Not if I can help it.
Let's see here. Nick's big pumpkin. He's here. I wonder if that's McCaslin. What do you guys think the ceiling is on all organic growing? Is it better for your patch in the long run?
Great question, Ron. Certainly better for your patch in the long run. I think, you know, me personally, what I'm seeing is it's like the 80-20 rule, like 80% organic, 20% synthetic seems to be a real sweet spot for people, or maybe 70-30. Once again, there's growers who have had tremendous success, you know, doing it organically. I know Mendy in France is an organic grower, and he's done very well. And I know other growers who have just put the synthetic fertilizer to them, and they've had tremendous success as well. I think as long as you're remineralizing your soil, and cover cropping and adding good guys too, because, you know, along with some of the synthetics and salts and some of the fungicides we have to use, you know, I've been a proponent of adding biology for years, and with the Essentials Companions, and now there's some other products that have come into the marketplace that people are using. So for me personally, I think a balance between organic and synthetic is the way to go. As far as organic, if somebody has enough mineralization, which I'm sure they can, I think they can grow just as big as what anybody else is doing, or bigger.
Gotcha. So we just got a handful more questions, and we're going to bounce over to the Wallace Wow questions. We want to try and respect Ron's time. He's got things to do.
Chad, I'm good. If people are getting something out of it, I shoveled snow all day, so I'm just, you know, if I was sitting here doing work, I'd be doing something on the website or... So I'm fine.
We'll keep rolling then. So keep asking questions, guys. Chris wants to know, I want to grow a giant pumpkin. Where should I get seeds, and how much water does it take? WallaceWow.com has some great seeds available. The Wallace Whoppers,
yeah,
or a club. Join your local club. People will give them away for free too.
I'd say the best way to get seeds is I still hand out more free seeds than I sell. And that's my commitment to the hobby. Like, you won't see my 2344 on my website, okay? Because I want the club auctions to make money. And that's always been my thing. After the club auctions are done, then I'll list them. Because, you know, the hobby has been selling them and making money. You know, join a local club, send a bubble pack to a grower. I still get hundreds of bubble packs a year. And they're all free seeds. And I have no problem doing that. That's fine. That's my commitment to help give back to the hobby. So you can start there, or you can go to my site. You can go to any of the other sites and get good quality seed. You know, I stand by, obviously, what's on my site. As far as water goes, that's another individual, depending on your patch and your type of soil you have. I think on average, most people are giving their plants anywhere from 75 to 150 gallons of water a day when they need to be watered. Some people do less. I know like Dave Stelz is in 50 gallons or so a day because he's got a lot of clay. And somebody like myself, it's like 100, 125, you know, when the soil's dry because, you know, we're sandy.
What do you think about hunk? What do you think about using pre?
Yeah, I need to, I know Dwight, you know, uses preen too as well. He told me, you know, maybe if he's online and he can chime in. I know a few other growers use it, and you know what? They've had tremendous success. So doesn't look like it's enabling their roots or anything. I'd have to look at it in an efficiency, a cost, an application. You know, I would like to see a few more people in the hobby do it. Hey, if weeds weren't an issue for all of us, it'd be a heck of a lot more enjoyable.
That's for darn sure. Long Range Crypto has asked this question, I think, in every stream, and now we got, the king that could potentially answer it. Why have all the self-pumpkins gone by the wayside?
I think the more you sell something, the more it reverts back to its original thing. I think sibbed up better than selfed, but I think adding other genetics from the gene pool, even though they're similar, always seem to work out better for vigor. It seems like there's been more issues with selfed pumpkins, but then I grew a world record off of a selfed seed, back a long time ago. So, but it seems like, to me, I always want to add something else from another gene line, and whether it's sibbed or something from another seed, I just think there's more variables for success with something. But once again, that may be a better question for a genetics expert.
Interesting. Has the sport been growing steadily over the years? Would you call it slow growth, explosive growth? In other words, what is your take on the rate of growth of the sport in recent years? That you're a good person to ask that. You've been around for a long time.
Yeah. I think
how much does it grow?
It's slow growth because, we're all faced with the same question. Unless your parents or your grandparents or a family member got you involved in gardening when you were young, if you lack exposure to something, it's not like you wake up one day in your late 20s and say, yeah, I think I want to garden. Generally, you'd have to have some exposure to it when you're younger. Unfortunately, a lot of people and a lot of younger generation don't want to be tied down working in a garden or mowing a lawn or planting a tomato when they can just go buy one. So the growth has been slow. I mean, I look around at a lot of the way-offs and to think, I'm getting to be one of the older group guys now compared to when I started. I'd like to see a lot more youth involved. That's why I try to get them started in the 150 square foot, meaning that they will have enough time and enough attention to take care of it. Also growing sunflowers. I try to get younger people involved with growing sunflowers because when kids see the sunflower grow every day, it keeps their attention and it gets them involved in gardening. So I think the growth is slow. Giant pumpkins really only get their notoriety for about a 3 or 4 week span. And it's not a cash crop. So it's slow, but it's always going to be there because, you know, so many people love pumpkins and a giant pumpkin. So we have to all do a better job of getting youth involved in our hobby, in the garden, because it's a trend that I see very difficult to get people involved.
That's right. That's why you should post more on social media.
Maybe you can help me with that this year. you know.
For sure. Yeah. Let's see. Matt's in the house. Matt DeBacco is here. All right, Matt.
Man, right there.
Oh, Matt's so cool. He's the guy that if you have your disease questions or your nitty gritty, if you have a word that you can't pronounce, Matt can tell you all about that.
Yeah, Matt gives another guy who gives a tremendous amount of his time and his you know, he's a really smart guy. He teaches for a living in agronomy, and he gives a lot back to the growers and the hobby.
I don't spend a ton of time on big pumpkins scrolling through the forums, but or the grow diaries. But Matt's grow diary is one that I look for every year because it has such good detail and documentation, and he gives you a lot of this is what I'm doing, this is why I'm doing it, and this is the result of it. Because so many people, I'm guilty of this. Like, you know, I kind of peter out towards the end. I get tired, and I don't pay enough attention to say, like, okay, you know, I did this different, and this was the definitive result when it's all said and done. And that's great at that.
It certainly is.
Let's see. Do you think you kind of answered? Barry, in the springtime, you want to pull them out. So let's see here.
That answer that question. That heating cables would be pulled out after the plant's done.
So let's talk about WallaceWild.com, Ron. You know, why did that come about? Where's the why behind it?
Sure. Well, I was, like I said, I worked in food service my whole life, and I was working 6 days a week, 15 hours a day, pretty much every day. And in the summer, we used to do about 255 weddings a year that don't include golf tournaments, and a bunch of other things. We were New England's premier wedding facility. And with that came an awful lot of work. So I was pretty much always either working or just working in the garden here. And, you know, in food service, I can tell everybody, when you go out to eat this weekend, go peek in the kitchen. There's really not really any older people working in a kitchen or the manager anymore because they burnt out. So I started feeling the effects and had some health issues of burnout. And, you know, I realized that things weren't getting better. So I ended up hooking up with the late, great Neil Anderson at RTI back in my early days of growing. And I had questions when the internet came out, and I started looking into biology and mycorrhizae and stuff. And then, and one day I came to him. I said, you know, Neil, I got an idea for a product line, you know, slightly different than what you're doing, but I think we could hit the home gardeners. And he said, Ron, I think it's a fantastic idea. So the last, you know, it took me about 3 or 4 years to develop, you know, all that packaging and labeling. Like I said earlier, you know, somebody emailed me once. They said, well, you just buy something and sell it. If you think I'm a person who just buys a private label and has no input to the manufacturing, all those labels, all that stuff was designed by myself and people on my team, an administrative assistant and people who work together to make it possible. It's not as easy as just rebranding something. So that took years to put that together. And then we did field trials for 3 seasons on the products, the soil and plant booster, the mycorrhizae. You know, my mycorrhizae is made and packaged specifically for me. The super starter packs, we did trials for years to make sure we had the formula correct. And then once we felt confident that we had what we wanted to, I went forward with the website, and I was still at the country club. And then the business started picking up a little more steam. And then, quite frankly, the cannabis boom went through the United States, and then the website really kind of caught fire. And I was at my time where I was done dealing with members of a country club and brides and all of that stuff. So it was a great segue into the business. And it wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for Neil and his wife, Maria, who have both passed away, who treated me tremendously. And with Neil, it was never about, he was never motivated by making money. He was one of the only businessmen, and I met a lot of them in my time being a country club general manager, that money wasn't his motivation. Yeah, he made money and did well, but he loved seeing the results of growers. He loved talking soil and pumpkins, and it was never about sales. And I remember my first couple of orders for a pallet, he was so nervous when I left my job. He didn't want me to leave it. He said, Ron, you've been there forever. You got a great job, great reputation. I said, no, I have to make this move for me. And my first law is put in. He didn't want to take any money from me. He said, no, pay me after you've sold it. And because I don't want you reaching out of your pocket right away until you get established. Now, how many other people are going to do that for somebody?
That's so cool. That's unheard of these days.
So that got going, and then we segmented into Canada on Amazon, and Eddie Zukowski helped me tremendously to get set up in Canada. He let me use his import-export number for a few years until I had one, which is big because it takes a while to get that. And so he helped me a ton getting set up in Canada, and I'll be forever grateful for that. And then Amazon here in the U.S. And we've actually kind of, you know, we're in a bunch of grow shops and things like that, and a lot of retail stores and stuff. I've kind of stayed away from all of that because I'm just plenty busy enough doing what we're doing now. So we're just going to focus and continue on the website specifically, and then Amazon secondary to that. So it's been a fun, really fun ride. It's rewarding to go to work every day, and a lot of passion and pride about it, because you get to talk to people who are generally happy. They're growing things instead of
right.
people complaining their steak was overcooked or
oh my gosh, I could only imagine that, and I don't want to. With that, what would you say if it's not imposing to ask, like, what is the percentage of like people who grow giant things versus everything else of your business? Is that like, I would say maybe 20% giant stuff and 80% everything else, if I was just throwing out a number?
Maybe 10% or less giants. And once again, I'm blessed that the giant pumpkin and the giant growers community has supported me. And I'm very, very thankful for that. And I'll never lose sight of that I'm very well supported, because I am a giant pumpkin grower and I always will be one. But there, like we said earlier, there's so many more people growing things other than giants. Like I said, the cannabis thing was huge. The cannabis bubble has kind of burst in most places and all that, but there's still always people who are growing in the backyard and doing stuff like that. So that'll still always be there. We do a lot with people growing roses, stuff like that. Everybody grows tomatoes and basil in a home garden, so there's so many more people growing, regular garden vegetables and flowers than there are giants. And when you're on the World Wide Web, you can, you fall into some of those categories, and that's where you pick up a lot of that extra business from people. There's just so many people growing so many things different other than giant pumpkins, but everybody grows a tomato and basil plant in their garden. Everybody. That's why the logo has a tomato on it. Everybody always said, why isn't your logo have a pumpkin in the center? I said, well, I never wanted to get pigeonholed with, people thinking that you can only grow a pumpkin.
Right.
And I figured the tomato is universal.
The giant pumpkin is definitely the poster child for, yield, no matter what you're growing. If I think people go to your website, and if they just research it a little bit, they're like, oh crap, this guy has grown behemoth pumpkins. And if he's using this stuff to grow a 2,000-pound pumpkin, like, what are my roses going to be like, or my tomatoes, or my candy, whatever it is. It's just the epitome of, getting the most out of your garden with whatever you grow.
Yeah, people enjoy the pumpkins, because if they don't come to the site for pumpkin stuff, I hear comments all the time like, holy shit, they'll send me an email, text me, is that real? And so it kind of stops them for a second to take a look. Like you mentioned about the website, I told you earlier, I've been working behind the scenes with a designer for about 6 weeks now. I'll have a new website out real soon. I really have to focus on a lot better quality images this year. Product images are perfect, but the kind of hero shots for the homepage I'm working on. So it's been a lot of work this winter. So we'll be rolling out a new website soon, which will load a lot faster. More videos, more stuff like that. So I'm really going to concentrate on that end of it this season.
Would it be perhaps, you know, we have 64 people in, one sec, buddy. We have 64 people watching right now, and then over the next week or so, we'll probably get a couple hundred replays. Would it be helpful for you at all if anybody has pictures of, you know, product of yours that they've used or you know, grows that have been successful in part to your product, if they sent that to you to, you know, add on the product images?
Absolutely. High quality, large images. If anybody has something, if they want to email it to me, I think I'm going to come back with a photo contest this summer because it really helped. You know, like I said, the grows have helped me, and they've helped me, you know, willingly with no hook on the end. Hey, Ron, can you use this photo or something? I've used a lot of them in my social media and things like that. So, yeah, if somebody has a high quality image or something they think could be helpful, send it along. I'd be appreciative to see it.
And reviews too. If you guys don't know, so or do, you know, if you buy a product from Ron, leave a review on it. That really helps, like the organic. So when you type like mycorrhiza, you know, that helps his product pop up first. And if it has good reviews, it just takes a second, leave a 5-star review. I'm guilty. I haven't done it, but I will.
Yeah, you know, it really does help. I was looking today, I didn't realize I'm over 5,400 reviews.
Wow.
Products now. So it really does help because a lot of people base their trust on reviews. And having said that, it's tough to get good reviews unless, you know, people have a connection with you. But if somebody feels wronged or the package showed up a day late or the box was cracked, they have no issue giving you a bad review and you can't take it away. It's just unfortunately the world we live in. Everybody's used to now, if they order something on a Monday, they want it Monday morning, Tuesday afternoon or Tuesday morning showing up. That's why we ship 6 days a week and ship as fast as we can because people are so used to, you know, Amazon type shipping.
Yeah. So let's put it this way. Ron's given us 90 minutes of his time. If you guys give Ron 5 minutes and go leave a good review or somewhere, that would be swell. I'm asking, not Ron. Ron wouldn't ask you, but I will. No,
but thank you.
In general, Ron, like what makes your if Joe Blow, Dr. Dave, who picked number 47, is scrolling on at 48. He changed his name. Oh, now he's on 14. If Dr. Dave was scrolling on Amazon and he sees Wallace Wild product for, you know, I don't know, $20, but we'll say mycorrhiza, but brand X is $18. You know, why is yours, you know, from a scientific perspective, why is it better? Why is it worth spending the $2 versus buying the kitty litter?
Well, you know, I stand behind a product. I work with Fernando, who's a microbiologist, you know, in manufacturing. Each batch, each product gets tested. And if the results aren't where they need to be, they're not gonna go in a wall bag, that's for sure. So we work very, very closely on the manufacturing. You know, there's a lot of people don't know there's two ways to manufacture mycorrhizae, in vitro in a glass or in vitro. You know, a lot of the products people send me now, what do you think of this one? I said, well, they're manufactured. A lot of these products are being manufactured in labs. So if they're manufactured in vitro in a lab, you have to use GMO type roots to do colonizing to get that in a lab. And they're done in a lab setting. Where ours is manufactured, grown on the host of plants, roots, plants, like I told you, zinnias, you know, celery, different plants, marigolds, different things that we're using to colonize mycorrhizae. Therefore, they colonize a lot better in our native soils instead of something that was done in petri dishes in a lab. And that's how you can get some ridiculous numbers by growing them in a lab setting. But sometimes between a lab setting and, you know, in an environmental setting are two different things. There's a lot of ridiculous prices of biological products on the market. And, you know, I always tell people just let the buyer beware. I know if they buy from me, it's gonna be fresh, okay? You know, I manufacture for me 4 to 5 times a year just to keep the product as fresh as possible and keep it rolling out the doors. I don't want it sitting on my warehouse shelf. I don't want it sitting, you know, in a box store's warehouse shelves, because anytime you put this stuff in a bag, even though it's dormant, you can start the clock ticking on it because they're just not meant to last for a couple of years sitting in an Amazon warehouse, not getting rotated properly and stuff like that. So I stand behind it. Anybody who has questions about it, they pick up the phone, they call me, they text me, they email me, and they'll always get a response, you know, from me. So I'll obviously stand by the product and help growers along with using the products. And I got an email today from somebody wanted to know why my prices on Amazon are slightly higher than my website. Well, that is simple. You know, Amazon, there's almost a 30% fee in there that they're taking for their wholesale type fee. And it's in a prime warehouse, so they'll get it to you the next day. They'll get it to you really fast. And there's a, you know, kind of a price to pay for that. You know, so that's why the Amazon prices are always going to be higher than my website.
Yeah. Is there any product specifically, you know, within the line that you carry? You know, this is a two-part question. Like, number one, what do you think your favorite product is that everybody should be using? And then number two, what do you think is the most underutilized or, you know, underperforming product on your website that doesn't make any sense to you? Like, why are people not buying that? I have those frustrations with my business. Like, this is a great deal. It's an awesome product. Why aren't you using it?
Yeah. You know, everything, I got to tell you, I was saying to my shipper the other day, I said, everything sells. Everything sells. I mean, I carry like 58 products. So I'm not carrying, you know, I'm bringing on a few more products soon because there's been enough demand from growers who have wanted them. You know, but everything pretty much sells. And my number one seller is the mycorrhizal inoculant. I mean, it does. I mean, if you're just growing vegetables or tomatoes, it does absolute wonders. So, you know, people have done tests recently for me. I did another, university did another test on my product versus some others. And another university in Canada bought some again today to retest it because they said the results were spectacular. And I said, it just makes things grow crazy because it's, you know, it's meant to colonize these type things. You know, you get a lot of products that will have a lot of different biology in the bag, but it might not colonize tomatoes, pumpkins, vegetables, cannabis, whatever you're using it on. I think the one, I sell a ton of my starter packs. I really do. But to me, that product still could even be more. It should overtake the 1 pound mycorrhizae. It's got a slow time release fertilizer in there. And it does just a tremendous job. You know, most home gardeners get kind of lazy. They're into it and early on, then a family vacation, 4th of July. By the end of July, early August, they want to pick a couple of tomatoes and they're done, maybe even before that. This is really once and done, you know, fertilizer. It does a tremendous job. And I sell pallets of it a year, but I always felt it should do better. I move a lot. Humic fulvic is another one that is slowly crept up the charts, is maybe like the number three. You know, I think a lot of people are using the humic fulvic for other things that aren't its intended purposes, like detox and stuff like that, because it's been the rage of the internet for a year about soaking your feet in humic fulvic, what people tell me. But I really, it's been a challenge at times to keep it in stock because I have it manufactured for me out of Canada and it takes some time to get here. And I've been, like every couple of weeks, I've been bringing in a pallet of it, and it's out the door quick.
Can it regrow hair?
I don't know. If so, I might need a little bit myself, and you certainly could use that.
Yeah, it's feeling a little chilly up top.
You know, everything pretty much sells. I try not to carry so many things. I don't just want something hanging around, taking up space. And if I don't use it myself and don't believe in it, I won't sell something just to make a dollar. It's just not me.
What's going on over there? So that's the next question is, I see that you brought in Hanna products. I purchased a new Hanna tester from you in last season. Do you have plans to expand your offerings, bring in new products that you know, you're confident you can stand behind, will do and perform as advertised that you want to sell to, you know, the community?
Yeah. You know, like I mentioned earlier, I'm going to bring in the Onset Hobo meters. I'm going to be working with the manufacturer to bring in the soil moisture, and they sell a moisture meter and the temperature is a combo, and then another one adds the EC to it. I really think those are very key in the future for growers to maintain consistency with their watering and their fertilizing. you know, because what you put in the tank for fertilizer, you know, it will build up over time in your soil. But, you know, I would test my soil once a week, doing a 2-to-1 soil to distilled water test. But it'd be really nice to know by just grabbing your phone and saying, oh, that's what my EC's at today. That's what my moisture level's at. So I'm bringing that on. Douglas Plant Health purchased growth products 4 or 5 years ago, or maybe a little longer than that. And they were carrying the essential, the companion, stuff like that. And then Douglas Plant Health also has, you know, SP1 and MT17. You know, Travis has had a tremendous amount of success with those products. I've had a lot of growers ask me. I used the SP1 and the MT17, you know, last year. I did see some nice newer roots later in the season that you know, sometimes you don't see. So I thought that was encouraging. They also have a few other products that I think actually have a bigger CFU content that I might bring in. So I'm going to be bringing a few of those products. And I'm also going to be working on an article for our club newsletter, because you know, a lot of growers, and specifically myself, have to get educated on how to read these labels. Like when you see these CFUs on labels and it's 1 × 4 × 3, and somebody will email me and say, well, what do you think of this? And once again, I was really educated by a friend of mine who's a scientist on how to read. You know, a lot of people, that's not their bag, mathematics and reading colony forming units and stuff. It'd be interesting to see that when you learn how to read a label, that some products are really kind of watered down and some are really high powered. So I'm going to work on an article, and it's going to be called What Do Those Damn Numbers Mean? And it's not going to be for me to pitch any specific product. As you know, Chad, I told you this before, I think I'm a pretty poor salesman because I don't put myself out there a lot and don't pitch a lot of things. But it'll let growers be able to read information and then read a label on any biological CFU product, and you can come to your own conclusion that if it's right for your garden or not. And there's other variable factors that you got to see if the products can perform in the field. It's one thing to be put into a jug and it looks good, but how does it work when it gets into the field? And once again, somebody bought a product recently. It was a friend of mine, and he didn't know I was going to be selling it. But then I said, why don't you look at that manufacturing date and the label for me, because they're going to be manufacturing for me soon. And I told him, listen, don't send me anything that's 6 months or older, because the product won't go off the truck. So first thing I'm going to look for, his product was a year and a half from the manufacturing date. They give you 2 years when it gets, you know, but I'm not trusting 2 years on any product that's put in a jug that could be in a warehouse. It's transporting in the summer, the trucks are warm, wherever it's going. So, you know, so that's why I work well with the manufacturers. Maybe they think I'm a bit of a pest at times, but they know me. I'm not going to bring in the product and have it, you know, where the shelf life's coming or it's really old. I've just seen enough of this stuff that goes bad pretty quick.
Yeah, and people need to understand. I think that there is a bit of a disconnect there, just in general, that from, let's say, it gets manufactured in California, you know, so it's manufactured in California. It goes in a freight truck, an LTL truck with no air conditioning. It's going through California, Nevada, Arizona, Texas, you know, where it's baking at 100+ degrees for days before it goes into probably a non-climate controlled warehouse. Non-climate controlled warehouse, and you know, you can't tell me that is not detrimental to the microbiology that you're trying to buy. So you know, you by doing things in smaller quantities and having a lot of control and super high standards is extremely valuable for the end user, and those are things that nobody is ever going to see and actually just realize. So hopefully they get a little bit of education on that today. So one sec, Charlotte wants to say hi to everybody.
Hi, Charlotte. Hi. How are you?
Hi.
Yep, Chad, another good point is is most of these products, they're all going to be a humic based carrier, because humic salt is great to add to your soil for basically feeding your soil microbes and carbon and all the good things that humic does for soil. Having said that, don't pay expensive amount of money for a jug that's just laden with humic acid, because humic, you know, when you break it down, it's one of the most reasonable things that you can buy. And a lot of products now are so heavily laced with humic. They're manufactured for the home gardener, but when they see the water turn brown, everybody gets excited. Oh my God, it's so good. It's got to be good for you. And actually, they're just selling humic at a really, really exorbitant rate. So that's something else to look at, because, you know, and humic, even if it's just straight humic, if you pay a lot of money, you pay a lot of money. It's damn good. You're paying, you know, a crazy amount of money just for a product that contains mostly humic acid. Good job,
for sure. So everybody, I've reached the end of my questions. Take the opportunity, you know, if you have a last second question, get it in. There's been a few people asking, what are the numbers? The numbers are for the group giveaway. Ron is going to give us some of his product and some of his seeds. That will be for the low, low cost of free, because Ron's an awesome guy. So pick a number, 1 through 75. At the end, I will throw those numbers into the random number generator. I will pick 9 numbers. And you need to stick around till the end, because we need to know your contact information. Jason, who is the producer of all this, will say, you know, 67, what's your contact information? Because otherwise, you know, I'll have Ron now send it to me, and that'll be great. So actually, you know, don't put your contact information. Just kidding, I need to get some of this stuff. Anyway, let's see, a couple of questions that popped in. Doc wants to know, how frequently do you use 5-2?
Pretty much almost every day that I water, I was putting like a quarter of a cup. Doesn't sound like a lot, but in, you know, a couple hundred gallons seem to do the trick. And it also helps stabilize, you know, my pH. You know, the humic will bump the pH up a bit. With my starting pH of my RO water being around, and rainwater being, you know, low sixes, by the time if you put any man-made fertilizer in there, you'd be in the high five. So I always wanted to be in the low sixes, the best for nutrient absorption. So the 5-2 would certainly help me, but I fertilize with it. And it's not a sales pitch. Pretty much every time I made water to fertilize, because I can believe you can't add too much, you know, humic fulvic to your soil. And the 5-2 came about based on that Virginia Tech 5-year study of the ratios, and you know, they had quite a bit of success doing that. And it's become you know, quite a popular product for us too.
Memo to self: buy some 5-2. Let's see, Mike. Knowing Mike, this might be a smart ass question, because I have no idea what that means.
Yeah, Mike, you might want to lay that out in layman's terms for me.
Where is this one? Here we go. Geo, what do you think will be the next 2365?
Yeah, once again, I think it's going to be something probably crossed in with the Indies. You know, seed. So, you know, like I said, I like the Casper line in with the Andy seed. For some reason, on paper, it just looks really good to me. But once again, this, you know, it's just a roll of the dice. There's so many good genetics out there, and there's so many of the same crosses done out there. And why will it hit for some and not for others? You got to get a little lucky too.
What, Gene's awesome guy. He took me to Gene's house. Fun fact, that was the biggest pumpkin I'd ever seen in person, was at Gene's beautiful property. You had a great grow diary in 2016. Do you see yourself doing that again anytime soon?
Gene, congrats on the Chiefs, brother. I'd love to, but when you do everything yourself, there's only so much time in the day. I do love big pumpkins, and I would love to come back and support that, but you know, it's just been difficult here in the last few years to try to maintain everything that's going on. But I really hope, I set out with high aspirations every year that I'm going to do the diary again and do something. And I hope to. So having said that, I hope I can stick with the commitment to do it. But it's been challenging because it's, you know, sometimes at the end of the day, you just want to sit down, have a cold beer and call it a day. And, you know, it's just one more thing to do. But I'm going to try.
That's a definitely a maybe, perhaps. Jason always uses the starter packs. Why is the 20? Oops, there we go. Why is the 2365 so desirable? Besides that, it grew the record. It's just growing huge pumpkins.
Yeah, it's just grow. That's the business we're in. It's just consistently grown big pumpkins. And I look for seeds that grow growers' personal best. If it's grown your personal best, a lot of times the seed is, you know, if it's done that consistently for growers, yeah, it's a really good seed. It's just, produced some tremendous fruit, and you know, overall the shapes and colors have been pretty decent on most of them. You know,
it was my 2365 was growing faster than any other pumpkin I've ever had. I was texting Mike and maybe even you, and like, I think I'm doing something wrong. I'm measuring wrong, but I wasn't. It was just growing that fast.
Yep.
People always leave bad reviews. Unfortunately, that's just how they are. Ron has the best customer service. Absolutely. Jason says it's all about that 5-2. Ron, I'm from Fur Island. Can I pick directly up from you?
Yeah.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Stranger danger, Dr. Dave. Stranger danger.
Yeah, Dave, there's plenty of guys who come by during the season, you know, and pick up hair and come around the patch. You're always welcome. So just shoot me an email.
Nice guy. Don't be an axe murderer, though. We like Rob.
Don't be a stalker.
Let's see here. I think, let's see, glad you use EC. So people use PPM.
Yep. You know, whatever way you want to look at it, it's an easy formulation. I have a shot outside, and that's kind of what I go by. And, you know.
Okay, just kind of scrolling through, let's see if there's any more questions. When do you think you'll see a 3,000-pound pumpkin?
I think the world record on average probably goes up on average 50 to 75 pounds a year, unless there's something that really breaks through. So having said that, you know, I still think like 3 years. Part of the country could come from anywhere, could come from Wisconsin, could come from, you know, Minnesota, could come from Michigan, could come from England. I think, you know, there's so many good growers now, and you know, everybody networking together. None of these pumpkins would happen if it wasn't for growers networking together. This is the reason why we've taken pumpkins from a few hundred pounds to on the verge of 3,000. We couldn't do that without people sharing and networking. That's a special thing about the hobby. So I think that world record obviously is going to happen, and it wouldn't surprise me, you know, in any location, California, you know, just take a map and throw a dart, and chances are, if they've got decent weather and they've got a good growing season, you can see it happen there.
Awesome. Well, on that note, you know, one more question, Ron. When it was, so back in the days before Tuhich, back before 2,000-pound pumpkin days, when you grew that pumpkin, you know, you had to have known that you had a chance, obviously. But when it was 2,009 pounds, you knew it was close. But can you describe the feeling, like the yeah, good job, son. Hold up that flyer. Can you describe, you know, the feelings or the anxiety, maybe some panic in there when that pumpkin went to scale and when they hit the button and it was 2,009 pounds, the first one ever to grow a one-ton pumpkin. Just what was that feeling like?
It's pretty good, not going to lie. But, you know, I had seen throughout that season that I had something that was growing faster than what we've ever had. But it was a year earlier that I had grown a pumpkin, and we called it the Freak. It had a horrible shape, but it was growing exponentially at a rate that I don't think had been seen in the hobby. So I knew the program was coming together. So as disappointed as I was, I knew I had a chance. I came right back the next year with the same system, had a better shaped pumpkin. We also had the New England patch tour here that year. And a lot of growers who came by, Matt was here, and a bunch of people, and they saw it, and you know, everybody thought I had a chance at it, and me, I kind of didn't think I do, because I think most growers kind of downplay what they have, not sandbagging, but you know, I'm not a boastful person, so it's kind of tough to pat yourself on the back. You know, some people don't have issues with it, but I certainly do. So I kind of downplayed it a little, because you never want to have your expectations too high. But yeah, it was really good to do something that, you know, people didn't think could be done, or be the first to do something. Because they can never take it away. You know, once you do it once, you know, I had that same feeling with the 1502. You know, that had never been broken, that barrier before. And yeah, I'm really proud of those programs, because those kind of basic programs in the 1502 and 2009, that was kind of when the internet was just getting started. And, you know, but a lot of those programs are still in use today, because we were still answering the questions back then. How big should the side vines be? How big should the plant be? How far out should it be? So we kind of put that information together in a basic program, and not just myself, a bunch of growers. And, you know, kind of moved it forward. And a lot of that basic stuff is still in the programs today. So that's what I'm most proud of.
That's really cool. Andy said he got a shipment today. Thanks, Ron.
Thank you.
This is an interesting question that I think is worth asking. Are we close to maxed out?
I think everything has a limit. You know, certainly does. But we haven't seen it yet. We haven't really slowed down yet, you know. As long as we keep up, I think it's good for the hobby when the record gets broken by that 25 to 50 pounds or so a year, instead of making that one massive jump. Like when Ian and Stewart had that 2,900 pounds, and I love those guys, and they're great. But if that 2,900 pounder made it to the scale and was, you know, I think it had another 50, 60 pounds or more to grow in it, you know, that sets that world record out there for 4 or 5 plus years to break. I think, you know, selfishly, when it's broken at a shorter amount each year, it keeps more of the enthusiasm rolling forward. Yes, everything has a limit. We're just not there yet, and I don't know what it is. But we still keep finding ways and creating ways to push the envelope with better soil biology. The technique, I feel, is pretty much there. The more and more greenhouse growers we get into it, I think at some point they're going to keep showing just what a greenhouse can do in the right environment. And I'm an outdoor grower. And, you know, I know outdoor growers can do it. You know, and hey, once again, look at what Travis has been doing. So we can do it. I just think the one to really hit the grand slam will probably be somebody who's really dialed in on a greenhouse.
Okay, you heard it here. So that is all the questions that we have. And thank you guys for... you know, tuning in, make sure again, subscribe to the channel, follow Ron and all of his social medias, leave him some good reviews. That is a massive help, because everybody knows when you're trying to go to a new restaurant, if it is a 2-star restaurant, you're probably not going there. But if it's a 4.5, 5-star restaurant, that's like, I'm definitely going there. So, you know, when I do all my shopping, I'd use it on the restaurant scale. Like, would I stop there? So, you know, help the guy out. Give them some good reviews. And again, I have the random number generator. I'll figure out a better way to do this. I have a random number generator on my phone. We're going to hit this button 9 times. We're going to get 9 numbers. Jason will talk in the chat, because we need to get your contact information. So the first one is number 19. You are the first winner. Number 15, you are the next winner, and I guess you guys can pick which product you want. Number 44, so that's number 3. 51, 6. 43, 7. 36, 8. 39, and One bonus one, number 15. And then my bonus, just in case we can't get a hold of two people, number 28. So there's all the winners. Ron, thanks so much, man. I really, really, really appreciate the time. We've had pretty much constantly 60 to 70 people coming and going, and we'll have hundreds of views of this after the fact, and probably thousands by the time summer goes around. So thanks so much. Thanks for all you do for the Giant Pumpkin community, having great customer service, and just being all around awesome man.
Thanks, Chad. Thank you for having me on tonight. And once again, thanks to everybody out there. Thank you to the growers, your kind words, your emails. I'm very thankful for it, and actually humbled by the amount of kind emails I received from growers. It's been a very rewarding experience, and thank you all very, very much.
Awesome. So, and again, follow Ron on social media, Instagram, Facebook, YouTube. He's on there. Check him out. I'll try to do a little more content posting. Leave him a good review. Takes just a few minutes. It's not a big deal. And if you're a customer of his, don't be afraid. Reach out. He's epic when it comes to customer service and in a day and age where customer service at times is non-existent. So, support people that do a really good job. Keep them around. And with that, we'll let Ron dream about shoveling snow tomorrow or the next day, whenever you need some more snow with the weather. And I'll keep the chat going. I'll keep the stream live for a few minutes so you guys can post. And my kids are starting to lose it. But thanks so much, everybody. Thanks, Ron, again. And we'll be back next week with another one.
All right. Yeah, you want me to log off now? Is that you know me with it comes with these Zooms?
Yeah, I think you're good to go, Ron.
All right, thanks a lot. Thank you, everyone, again. Peace. Go Bills.
See you guys. Good morning, Mommy, says Pepper and Jewel. Man, that was awesome. Ron is an A-plus guy, and I see so many A-plus people here in the chat. Gene was nice enough to let me look around his house when I was doing a tour at Ron's. Gene has an amazing property. Saw Tobacco in here. Matt's a super awesome guy. If you ever have any questions, hit up Matt. He's a vastly underutilized resource at times. Moby Mike's in here. Great guy. A man, a smart-ass human man of my own kin. I love it. Pumpkin Club. Who else we got in here? So, Jason, when you guys see the stream link, comment on there because then we can take your questions and I put them in before. So, that's about it. Oh, Don's in here. Hey, Don. Don's one of my favorite girls. Super helpful to me. It always goes rock solid boulders. As they park by the playground. Who else did we get? All sorts of people. So again, if you're not reaching out, yeah, can man, you got to come back to Colorado. Matt will show you the new greenhouse, much much better. And there's a guy named Brad, and I don't want to say anything too nice about Brad, but Brad has he's building a super nice greenhouse now that should be awesome. I know Jason's been helping him with it. So again, post in here if you won. Matt or Jason will reach out to you and connect you with Ron. So I've got to take care of the kiddos. I'm going to sign off. It's past their bedtime, and then went out to dinner and left me all alone. And we'll catch you next week. I think we have Jason. Who's next week? You texted me. Next week we have. And then quickly hurries up to the slide again. We have Doc Rodenbaugh. The PPFD is the number of photons that in fall in 1 square meter, the photo period duration. Pepper says, stop Mike, crying, that, George. Come on. You can now, try Mike. The slide now. I ain't that George smart. Ron might have known. Not me. All right, guys. Pepper have a good one. See ya. And hops onto the swing.